welcome. I'm Elizabeth Mahusai. I appreciate you taking the time to watch this video and also for me to be able to share it with you. Transform thinking, I am incredibly passionate about. Why? Because having been that independent, self-sufficient, get-her-done person, I did not get there overnight. And I, in having the desire in my heart to be a Godward thinking, others-focused woman, did not happen overnight. It was a process that God took me through. And that process of transformed thinking, which happened over a number of years, and it's still happening day by day. It's a progressive work in our lives. It's out of that that I'm going to share with you some very clear things that God has taught me in that process. Do you know that in Ecclesiastes 3, I love the book of Ecclesiastes. In the beginning of Ecclesiastes, you probably know it because you know there's a popular song out there where he says, there's a time for, there's a time to be born, there's a time to die, there's a time to plant, there's a time, you recognize that? Well, later in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, it says that God has made everything beautiful in its own time. He has implanted eternity in the hearts of man. Okay, so I want you to imagine that my shape sorter, you know the shape sorter, right? Like the little toddlers, you get the shape sorter, and you know, they're doing the exercise of color and shape, and you know, you watch them, like they can spend all that time, and it's like, and you're thinking, you're going to drive me nuts. Just put it right, and you wanna just like guide their hand to it, right? Because so they can stop. Okay. So I want you to imagine that that eternity that God has implanted in your heart, in the heart, I want you to think not so much as in the physical heart as we know it, but scripturally, oftentimes the heart represents the emotional seat of the person. And so in your mind, God has implanted that star thought of eternity, the fact that you are made in God's image, that He has perfectly designed you, that is within you. He has implanted that in you. And so you are implanted with that eternity. But see, here's what happens. From the very beginning with Adam and Eve, you know, sin corrupted things in the world, okay? And it took what God implanted and it began to kind of muck it up. And so as a result, because we deal with this issue of sin and wrong thinking, we begin to exchange God's way of thinking for the world's way of thinking. It's progressive over our life, but we begin to exchange God's way of thinking about ourselves and about the world and about how we should interact with the world with the world's way of thinking. And this is why, if you have children, I don't care how old they are, from this moment on, you could commit that you're gonna really focus on getting them to be Godwardly focused, so that they are letting God determine who they are and how they think and how they engage the world versus I'm going to control who they are, how they think, and how they embrace the world. And I'm telling you, it can be a struggle because you're fighting against, I want my kids to make me look good. Yes. So that when they're slouched in church, and they want to put the hoodie over their head, and you're thinking, you're making me look bad. Those are the kinds of, I mean, it's, the struggle is real. The struggle is real. If you, hashtag struggle is real. Yes, I love it. Okay. And so when you come to retreats like this, what happens is because, one, just because of Haven property itself, you are going to feel, and you might likely have already felt it, it's like God is trying to pull you back to that eternity that He has implanted in your heart. It's like you sense something. Most people come and they don't really know what it is. They can't really put their finger on it, but there's something about being here, and they're hearing the training and they're hearing the testimonies and they're seeing the servanthood of that Premier establishes. And it's as though God is reminding you of the eternity that He has placed in your heart. And then what happens is you have this sense of, I can do it. This is why God gave me Premier, and I'm going to go back, and I'm going to make phone calls, and I'm going to do text messages, and then I'm going to go to training, and I'm going to do all of these things. And 24 to 48 hours after you leave, life continues, right? And I'll call that the Snicker bar effect. You're on the high, and then life occurs, and you're in the pit. And you're thinking, all of those things I said I was going to do, I'm pitching that out the window because life is hard. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
And so in order to leave here, not just energized, not just reignited for your business, but to actually act in a way consistently that will make a difference in your life, in your marriage, in your parenting, in your business, we've got to address our thinking. Okay, so let me give you some statistics about your thinking. You think 60 to 90,000 thoughts a day. 96% of them are the same every day. That's some of the research that I've read. 60 to 90,000 thoughts a day, 96% are the same. If you were thinking positively yesterday, you're thinking positively today. If you were thinking negatively yesterday, you're probably thinking negatively today. If you came here with a marriage that is not going well, it's a day-to-day thought process that you likely have to fight against. And eventually, if you don't change your thinking, that thought process will win over and you will no longer want to fight those negative thoughts about your marriage. You will begin to look for a way to have comfort in the midst of the stress and the struggle. You will look for an out. It is the progression that occurs. And so 60 to 90,000 thoughts a day, 96% of which are the same. And so you have to ask yourself, do I like the thinking that I have on a daily basis? Because if your answer to that is no, then I want to present to you that we need to each be going through transformed thinking. Okay, so I want to pause because I want to make this real for you. Just toss out for me a handful of negative thoughts that we could have about our businesses. What are some negative or discouraging thoughts? I didn't get it done on time. Yes.
They'll probably cancel.
Oh, that is so, that's yes.
No one's gonna come.
There's only two people that have negative and discouraging thoughts. That's really good. In a room this, I can't get any bookings. I call that my booker is broken. My booker is broken.
She's not worth my time.
It's not worth my time. She's not going to sign up, you know, to actually do it.
My jewelers will not call me back.
What am I? Am I a leper? You know, what's the problem, right? I mean, because what? We personalize everything. We think they're not calling me back because clearly I've done something wrong. And you know what's so funny? Most of the time when your jewelers don't call you back, they're not calling you back because they think, I don't want to call her because she's going to ask me what I've done and I don't want to have to tell her I've not done what I'm supposed to do. Right? She's not calling you because she doesn't want to feel badly about what she hasn't done or how it hasn't gone the way that she thought it would. So interesting how women personalize things. Okay. So here's the thing. We are going to have negative and discouraging thoughts about any area of our life. It is the nature of living in a world that we do. I want to help us to kind of clear our minds, okay? So I want you to repeat after me. And so as the teacher, this is where we do choral response. So I'm going to say it, and you're going to all together chorally respond back. Ready? Okay, here goes. Time's needed.
Time's needed.
Just pray.
Let God's voice permeate.
Let God's voice permeate. Let's do it again. Time's needed.
Time's needed.
Just pray.
Just pray.
Let God's voice permeate.
Let God's voice permeate.
Okay, now, I realize that you've kind of been sitting here all morning, so let's say it again with a little bit more gusto. Ready? Time's needed.
Time's needed.
Just pray.
Just pray.
Let God's voice permeate.
Let God's voice permeate.
Okay. So I want to talk with you real quickly, and I'm going to make this a more briefer overview between the conscious mind and the unconscious mind. Unconscious and subconscious could be synonyms for each other, okay? Your conscious mind is the one that's always commenting. It's when you walked into the room, you paid attention to the green and the colored streamers. It's always commenting. Your conscious mind is what's assessing the people who go by you, their hair, their clothes, their whatever it is. You're making assessments. It's always commenting. You use your conscious mind to recall past events. You use your conscious mind to learn, like right now as you're listening to me, that's your conscious mind processing what you hear. You'll use it to focus when you're working on those new skills. It is your thinking mind. That's what your conscious mind is. It's the one you're most aware of. Now, your conscious mind can actually process 40 bits of data per second. So 40 bits of data per second. That's your conscious mind. Now, your unconscious mind, you're unaware of. Your unconscious mind is responsible for bodily functions like digestion, your heart beating, your lungs expanding and exchanging that deoxygenated for oxygenated. All of that is happening through your unconscious. Your unconscious is where you store learned skills. You know, like most of you got up this morning, and hopefully in the same way that I encouraged our youngest to brush his teeth, you probably brushed your teeth. And you did not have to think about, because you've been doing it for so many years, you didn't have to think about open the cap, squeeze the tube, put it on the tube. Like that's all unconscious, right? You also know that you store learned skill because when you drive, have you ever been driving and you drive into your driveway and you think, how'd I just get here? Did I stop at the light? Did I run that stop sign? Listen, we don't have to be on our phone to be unconscious about our driving, okay? Which is why if you put those two things together, we should be scared, okay? All right, so your unconscious mind stores that. Now here's another important thing about the unconscious mind. It stores things about your character and your identity. It stores things about your character and about your identity. It is your best friend. It cannot determine lie from truth. That's very, very important. It is your best friend. It will not tell you the difference between a lie and a truth. You step in front of the mirror and you think, man, I look fat today. Your subconscious is gonna go, yeah, girl, you do. Your subconscious is your best friend. It will agree. It will not differentiate between truth and lie. Do you understand the power of just that right there? That what you say to yourself, what you think about yourself, makes a difference in your life because your unconscious is going to automatically agree with that. It does not discriminate. Now, here's the interesting thing about the unconscious mind. I'm just going to make that UM. It processes, are you ready for this? 40 billion bits of data per second. Now, you should not be surprised by that. Why? Let me just give you the quick, you know, it's my one little moment to like get a little science in for you, okay? So your ocular nerves right now are processing depth, distance, color, texture. That's just your ocular. Your hearing, those cochlear nerves in your ears are hearing the sound waves that are coming into your ears. They're sending signals to your brain. Your brain is causing your body to respond. Your skin right now is assessing the temperature in the room, whether you have chill bumps, whether you feel hot, whether you're pitting because you're speaking, whatever it is, your skin is addressing that, okay? Think about all the things that are happening in your unconscious mind of which you are unaware. 40 billion bits of data per second. Now, let me make this real for your mind. So in your mind, what your mind does is I want you to think conscious mind, what we're thinking here. I have this thought. I'm in front of the mirror. The thought is I feel fat today. It's in your conscious mind. When you allow it to hang out in your conscious mind enough, or if you rehearse it enough, eventually, it is going to make its way into your unconscious mind, that's the inside, and it's going to hang out in there. And now, it's going to, when you think about yourself, it's going to be filtered through what your unconscious mind has stored about you. So let me give you two scenarios. Jeweler A grows up in a family where she has awesome parents, and they are telling her things like, Kathy, you are beautiful. You can do anything that you put your mind to. You are so intelligent. We are so excited about what God's going to do in your life. And so Kathy, she has all of these star thoughts, that's what I'm going to call star thoughts, that have been stored in her unconscious mind. So she comes to premiere, and she hears Tim Horner or Randy Draper or people who stand in front of her, and they're saying, Kathy, you can do this business. God has given you this business. You can do whatever you put your mind to with the help of God, and we'll call those star thoughts. And guess what? Kathy goes, yeah, that is so true. And she feels empowered and energized, and she operates on that. But let's do Jeweler B, who grows up in a more challenged home. And she has parents that oftentimes, without thinking about it, will go, you're wearing that today? That makes you look ugly. I can't, or that makes you look fat. Oh, and I have a little fat thought going on in my mind. Not because they're thinking about it, or it could come in the form of, you're going to eat that? I have to watch this about myself when it comes to my boys as well. Because what? You're wanting to be helpful, right? You know where that could lead, but you don't realize what your words can do. And they tell you, you'll never amount to anything. And then you share with them, hey, I'm doing this premier jewelry business. And they go, what? You're doing that pyramid thing, that multi-level marketing? You'll never be successful in that. And you come into premiere and you hear those same star thoughts that Kathy heard. You can do this. God has given you premiere. And you try to bring that thought into your unconscious mind. And no matter how hard you try, it does not fit. And this is what tends to happen. Well, that must not be for me. That's only for her or for those people who are successful. And oftentimes, we will quit because we've never addressed the thinking that has been stored in our unconscious mind. Listen, you will never be able to exercise your way out of a bad diet. You can't. You cannot exercise your way out of a bad diet. Why do I say that? Because that connects with women right away. So let me say this to you. You cannot, in the same way that you cannot exercise your way out of a bad diet, you cannot motivate your way out of bad thinking. It doesn't work. It'll be short-lived, short-term. It does not have lasting effect. It is the Snicker bar that will put you down in that sugar, you know, dump once you've had it. You cannot motivate your way out of bad thinking. You have to address your thinking. And what I want to do is give you 6 steps to methodically work through your thinking process. So here we go. Let's launch. Number one, you got to decide you want to change your thinking. You have to decide that you want to change. No one can change it for you. So here's the thing. If you keep doing what you've been doing, you will keep getting what you've been getting. And I'm going to rework that. If you keep thinking what you've been thinking, you will begin to act on what you're thinking. Why? Because you begin to believe it. Let's make this a negative thought. If you keep thinking, I can't book shows. You rehearse it. You don't realize you're rehearsing it, but you rehearse it over and over and over again. That thing gets lodged in your subconscious. You meet Krista, who's loving your jewelry. She's excited. Maybe she's even at a jewelry show. And rather than asking her or being a little bit more pleasantly persistent about getting her on the calendar, in your subconscious mind, when you have that thought of, oh, Krista might book a show. Hey, that's a star thought, right? Oh, but you know, I've already rehearsed over and over again that people aren't booking. My booker is broken. And so you know what? I'll hold back. I won't ask her or I won't pursue her. Why? Because I just have already decided what the outcome is. Have you done it? I know I have. And so we've got to decide that we want to change. Now let me just tell you, I'm going to give you the brief of when this happened for me. So, you know, I'm in that independent, self-sufficient, get-her-done mode. I get into Premiere. I mean, all of my life, I have done the whole, I'm just going to work hard. I'll do whatever it takes to succeed. I did it in school. You know, I had the grades to show it. I had the same mentality when I went to college. And I come into Premiere, and, you know, I was doing well in one sense. I mean, I did 60 jewelry shows my first year, but I didn't sponsor anybody my first year. I wanted to. Oh, yeah, I declared to my sponsor, oh, that sponsoring thing, I want to do that. Because I enjoy coaching and mentoring women. And she was like, okay, you know. And so I didn't sponsor a single person. I held 60 shows. Do you know that statistically about 1 in every 10 of your hostesses should become a jeweler? How many should I have had?
Six.
How many did I have? Zero. And that was the first step. So sponsoring in Premiere was one of the first ways that God went, oh, so you're not so good in and of yourself to be able to get her done. Not that God has that kind of inflection, right? But it does make it a little more fun. And I was very frustrated. You know that I thought after I had made about $12,000 our first year in Premiere, I was thinking about quitting. Because money doesn't keep people in this business. Did you know that? Money does not keep people in Premiere long term. Ultimately, it's sponsoring that keeps people in Premiere long term. Because it's people whose lives are being enriched, whose lives are being transformed. That's what will get you up out of bed and keep you up late at night, because you are energized to see what God is doing in people's lives through this business. And so ultimately, I humble myself. I humbled myself to an extent, okay, because God always finds unique ways to humble me. I always say he has such a sense of humor in the ways in which he will choose to humble me. But I came into my second year in Premiere and had a different mindset. I submitted to the leadership of my upline. I started listening to her. Imagine that, you know, and it kind of worked because like she was sponsoring and being successful and yeah, just try it really. It does, it's good. It's good for you. And so I sponsor 9, and we make designer circle, all that good stuff, get to walk stage, you know, of course it's feeding my achievement orientation because, you know, when you're all that in a bag of chips, you like to achieve, right? You get that, right? Okay, so I go to this leadership retreat, and all the while of my first year and a half in Premiere, this is what I've been hearing, that the undertone that would get back to me is, you're so intimidating. I would hear from Kelly, you know, she's this sweet, phlegmatic, and she'd be like, oh, well, you know, so-and-so thinks you're so intimidating. Well, I mean, actually, this is what she told me. I mean, really, I was intimidated by you. I mean, it was just, but you know, I just tell them once they get to know you, they'll like you. Okay, and I'm telling you, after a year and a half, I'd had enough. Mm-hmm. So we're at the hotel, we were there for this leadership conference, and the conversation comes up about so-and-so thinks you're so intimidating, and I was indignant. You know what? I am sick and tired of hearing people talk about how I am so intimidating. I do not understand why they say that. Now, Kelly, the sweet gal that she is, she now reverts into, I'll be a wallflower. I don't want to be in this conversation. You know, because we want to conflict avoid at all costs. And the other gal who was there, she was like, well, I'll tell you why. And I was like, well, do tell, because I want to hear. I mean, literally, I mean, you know, choleric to choleric. Give it to me, baby. And she goes, well, they think you're so intimidating because you dress well, you speak well, and for the most part, they think you're perfect, and they can't relate to that. And this is exactly how I responded, and since Fred's the only male in the room, you know, I can say it. Well, that's funny. When I stand naked in front of the mirror, I don't see perfection. And, of course, the conversation ended, as you can imagine. I go home to Fred, and I'm like, you are not going to believe what so-and-so said. He was like, what? I'm like, she said, this is why people say that I'm intimidated. And do you know what he said in response? He was silent. So let me give you man speak about silence. This is man speak about silence, confirmed by Fred. If I say something, I'm in trouble. If I don't say something, I'm in trouble. But if I don't say something, I'm in less trouble.
Preach.
Yeah. And that was the moment that I realized that who I was in public is not the same as who I was in private. See, people would like me when they got to know me because who I was in private was not who I projected in public. I had created an image. I had crafted a look. I had crafted good speech. I could tell you the Bible verses. I could talk to you about God, but I wasn't living with a Godward others focused. I was living for myself. What I could achieve, what I could do, how it would benefit me. Now, would I verbalize that to you? Did I wake up every morning and go, oh, yeah, today? No! We're not thinking that, okay? But that was that moment, and I'll tell you, for about 18 months, I felt like I was in God's meat tenderizer. You know those wooden-handled, like, waffled hammers that, you know, you're supposed to use to tenderize meat? Oh, yeah. I felt like I walked around with a tick because God was tenderizing me to reveal to me, listen, all this time you've been doing. I'm not looking for doing. I just read 2 days ago, I wrote it. I have a whiteboard in our bathroom. There are things that when they hit me, I'll write them on there, and then I'll reflect on them, and I'll kind of rehearse them in my mind to anchor those biblical principles in my mind. And this was the principle. Real solid sin, that's what God's looking for. The confession, the admission of real solid sin, that's what he's looking for. And do you know what he gives you in exchange for it? Real solid righteousness. Why? Because when I am at abject poverty, I realize I've got nothing I can give to this except the recognition that in and of myself, I am a wretched, sinful woman. It is at that moment that God will gladly exchange the sin for real, solid righteousness. I want you to think right living, right thinking. That's what we're after here. And so you've got to decide you want to change. Second thing, you've got to pay attention to what you're thinking. What are you thinking? What thoughts come into your mind? It's going to look like this. You're in front of the mirror. You're getting ready. And you have this thought of, I'm not pretty. Okay? That's a thought that comes into your mind. You've got to learn to not just let that hang out in your mind. It's going to look like this. I'm not pretty. It's happening. And you go, whoa, let me just take a look at that thought. Let me examine that thought. Is that thought life building, image building, or image busting? The thought that I'm not pretty, is that going to build me up? Make me think more that I'm made in the image of Christ, or make me think less of I'm in the image of Christ? And I have to start paying attention to thoughts in that way. I've got to pay attention. By the way you pay attention is you've got to create some silence in your life. We are too distracted. You need to have less television, less radio, less phone. Now, I'm not saying you give it up, but I'm saying, have you ever driven 10 miles with no radio, not being on your phone, and just listen to what's going on in your head? You see, I believe we have become so distracted as a society is because we don't like what's happening in our head, and rather than address it, we want to ignore it. We want to suppress it. We want to cover it up. Interesting that you would bring me a Band-Aid, because this is what we want to do. Rather than address this negative junk that's in our mind, rather than bring it through and go, I need to consider that, rather than doing that, I'll just put a Band-Aid over it. It's called add one more thing to my activity schedule. It's called let's just have one more baby because that's going to make it better. It's called you fill in the blank, you get what I'm saying, right? We try to Band-Aid that thing rather than actually address it. You've got to pay attention to it. Number three, you've got to filter your thoughts through the truth of God's Word. Oh, I got to make this a short version. Filter your thoughts through the truth of God's Word. Let me show you what that might look like. This is what I have for you here, Philippians 4:8. Paul, in the book of Philippians, is writing from a prison cell. He is chained to guards. And he's writing to the church in Philippi, and he's talking about joy. And he's reminding them of who they are, what God has done in their fellowship. I mean, and it's just, Philippians is one of those books of the Bible that you can read in a very short period of time. And what you will find are so many awesome biblical truths that you can apply immediately in your life. Like Philippians 1:6 that says that he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. In Philippians 2 where it says that Christ is the ultimate example of what it looks to be humble. That he humbled himself, not considering it equal to be in form of God, but that he became a bond servant, a bond slave here on earth. I mean, that's Philippians 2. In Philippians 3, it talks about how I'm going to forget what is behind. I'm going to press forward to what is ahead, towards the upward call of Christ Jesus in my life. And he gets to verse chapter 4, and now he's saying, this is, by the way, right after a passage that some of you probably know by memory, be anxious for nothing, but in all things through prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. I mean, how many of you also struggle with being anxious for nothing? Yeah. And so he gets to 4:8 and he says, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, virtuous and praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Not you should consider it, not you should think about it, but this is what you should do. And so filtering our thoughts looks like this. I'm not pretty. Whoa, let me think about that thought. Let me filter that thought through the truth of God's word. Is it true? According to Psalms 139, 13 and 14, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. God knew me before he knit me in my mother's womb. That is not true. And I'm going to get to what we do with that in a moment. I don't think my husband does enough. As a matter of fact, I think I have to do everything. Let's filter that through the truth of God's word. Is that worthy of respect? Because listen, I went to the refrigerator one day. I grabbed the refrigerator handle. Not like it reminded me of Fred or anything, but I just had that thought appear in out of the blue. Fred never does anything. Now listen, you hang out on that thought. You hang out on that thought, you know what happens? You go, what does your subconscious say? Oh yeah, he never does anything. You have to do everything. And then you go, yeah, that's right. And then you start looking for every example of how that is true. And then you start treating him as though he doesn't do anything. So I have to go, is that worthy of respect? Yeah, I seem to recall that he gets up and he takes those boys to school so I don't have to get ready, make sure I have at least lipstick and, you know, what do you call those things? Sunglasses on. Hey, if he took a shower that day, that's worthy of respect. It's the truth. Okay, obviously some of your husbands have less body odor than others, but okay. You're supposed to laugh at that. Okay. You have another thought. That hostess stands you up when you schedule something with her. And you want to go, what? Don't you know this is my business? Why would you do that? And you have to ask yourself, is that fair? Do I know every detail that may have led to this circumstance? No. So I've got to filter my thoughts through the truth of God's word. And here's the thing. I can't filter my thoughts through the truth of God's word if I am not in God's word. I can't filter my thoughts through the truth of God's word if I am not hiding any of God's word in my heart. Now, am I suggesting that you have to know huge portions of scripture? No. Do I think it would be helpful? Yes. But if you're not even reading his word, it will be very difficult to filter through his word. So you've got to filter. Number 4, you got to reject wrong thinking or lies, and you have to replace it with truth. Reject wrong thinking and replace it with truth. Just for the purpose of illustration, I call this substitutionary thinking. So, and that thought of I'm not pretty, you filter it. God's word says, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You say, that's a lie. I'm going to reject that. I'm going to replace it with truth. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. And you preach it to yourself. Every time that thought comes into your mind, because you know it will come back, yes? It's not going to just go away right away. It's a progression that occurs. It's a demolishing that has to happen. In 2 Corinthians 10, starting in verse 4, 5, and 6, it says, you must take every thought captive and make it obedient to Jesus Christ. But even prior to that, it says that we're going to demolish every stronghold that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. Do you know what demolishing looks like? I don't feel pretty. I reject that. That is a lie. I'm going to replace that with the truth of I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I don't feel pretty. No, I reject that. I know that is not of the Lord. I'm going to replace that with I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I'm going to focus on what is true and just and noble and pure. It is a demolishing of the strongholds that have set themselves up in your mind. No one wants to book a show. Is that true? No, that's a lie. What am I going to replace it with? There are women out there who have a need, who have a need for companionship, who have a need for fellowship, who would love to get jewelry for free and half price. Every time that thought that no one wants to book a show, I reject that thought. That is not of the Lord. He gave me this business for a purpose. I'm going to replace that with the truth that there are women who desire to get jewelry for free and half price. Lord, open my eyes to see them. Open my ears to hear them. The more you demolish the strongholds that have set themselves up in your mind that are against the knowledge of God, and you begin to take every thought captive and you make it obedient to Jesus Christ, you replace the lies and you reject them and you replace them with truth, you are going to see transformation in your thinking. Over time, it can and will happen. This is what we're talking about in Romans 12, where it says, dear brothers and sisters, present your bodies as a reasonable sacrifice. Present your bodies as a sacrifice before the Lord. This is your reasonable act of service. Do not be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You got to renew your mind daily. Now, how do you renew your mind daily? You get in the Word daily. Listen, this is not about being legalistic, okay? I'm not saying it has to be this time and this way. What I'm saying is that to have the fulfillment of renewing your mind daily, to effectively take every thought captive, to reject lies and to replace it with truth, be in the Word daily. Why? Because what did I say? The more you know God, the more you believe God, the more you believe in you that He created you to be, the more powerful your thinking will become because you'll be filtering it through the truth, not through the ever-changing what the world wants to call truth, but the truth of God that has been in existence for thousands of years, forever, because He has always existed. And so you've got to reject and replace. And then number five, you've got to repeat. And I like to add some other P words with positive phrasing, with passion and persistence. And I've already kind of demonstrated that for you with the 2 Corinthians 10, 4 through 6. Do you know how you take a sledgehammer and you tear down a brick wall? One swing at a time. You want to take care of the negative thoughts that have built up that brick wall in your mind, that daily you feel like you're hitting up against a wall that will not move, because you're probably focusing on using your own power and your own strength rather than tapping into the power that God provides for you. The best way to tear down those walls of negative thinking and lies that we have allowed to build up in our mind is to take a swing with the sledgehammer of God's Word. Because it's through the power of His Word that you can not only take the thought captive, not only can you replace it with truth, but you can do it. You're equipped for the fight because it's a fight and it's a daily fight. But man, is it a worthwhile fight. Number six, you got to find and submit to accountability. Find and submit to accountability. You need someone who loves you enough to tell you what you need to hear, not what you want to hear. You need someone who loves you enough to speak the truth in love. You need someone who knows you well enough that they can help you uncover poor areas of thinking in your life, in your business, in your marriage, you need someone who loves you enough to call you out. What would that look like? Your friend says, when they go in to get their picture taken, oh, I don't like the way I look, I don't like this, and you go, are you hearing yourself? This is what a friend does. Are you hearing yourself? What words are you putting out for your enemy to then form into a stick to hit you with? That's the truth. Your enemy is the prince of the airwaves. He hears what comes out of your mouth. Why would we give him negative things that would then be utilized against us later? That's what we're doing. And you know what? We do that where our children are concerned, and we do that where our husband is concerned, and we do that about our jewelers and about our hostesses. We speak things out negatively, not thinking about how our enemy will use those against us in the future. And it'll sound something like this. We speak it out. My husband never does anything. We're talking to our girlfriends, right? And then we go home and something's not done. Your enemy goes, see? He really doesn't do anything. And you go, yeah. What's your subconscious do? Yeah, he doesn't do anything. And so you've got to be careful what comes out of your mouth. Listen, what comes out of your mouth, oh, hear this. What comes out of your mouth is based on a thought that has been hanging out. It's well formed. It's gone to belief stage in your subconscious because you are now willing to speak it for all to hear. What comes out of your mouth speaks a truer picture of what's happening in your mind than most anything else. And so it's a good indication of where you are when you really pay attention to what you speak. So let me just wrap it up with this. From a business, marriage, parenting standpoint, part of the reason why we want to give up and we want to quit is because we have not done something enough to move it from our conscious mind to our unconscious mind. Okay? I want you to think about the skill required to do your business. Jewelry shows, phone calling, follow-up, OPs, all of those things that are necessary in your business. If you do not do them enough to move them as a learned skill from your conscious mind to your unconscious mind, what happens is you get stressed out really easily in your business. Getting ready for a jewelry show when you're only doing 1 to 2 every now and again looks like this. I have a show. I need like a half day. I got to get my jewelry ready. Are the tags ready? Are my boards ready? Do I have guest surveys? Do I have order forms or even stamps? Or even do I have order forms? Oh my goodness. I'm on Facebook going, does anybody have any order forms? I have a jewelry show tonight and I need some order forms. And then you get to your show and you're like, oh, I haven't set my jewelry up in a really long time. I mean, I don't know. I don't want it to look messy. I don't want it to look ugly. They're going to think that I don't know what I'm doing if it doesn't look good, right? And so I am like stressed out and I get done with my show and I'm like, oh my goodness, that is not worth it. Someone said that earlier. That is not worth it. Why am I doing this to myself? You know why? Because your conscious mind only has 40 bits of data per second to process things. 40 bits of data is not a lot when you're working your business on your conscious mind. And you get a call that kind of rocks your world, whatever that call is, and you're trying to go into your show and you've added something else to your conscious mental plate, you know the first thing you want to eject? Your premier business. Versus you do those 6, 9, 12 shows in a short period of time, you understand how to set up for a show. You understand the basic rudimentary routine that you go through. What happens is you're moving it from your conscious mind to your unconscious mind. You know you're there when it's time to get ready for a show, and you go, okay, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, I'm packed up, I'm out the door, I get to my show, I can talk to my hostess, I can be setting up jewelry, I kind of get my stuff ready, I mean, I'm low-key. Why? Because it's all in my unconscious mind. It's like driving home and getting into the driveway and going, how did I just do that? That's what you want in your business. You want unconscious-minded operation. Why? Because then life can happen. Emotions can fluctuate, and your business can remain rock steady because you have moved it from your conscious mind to your unconscious mind. Please tell me someone here sees the power in understanding just that alone about what I've said to you. Okay. Remember that whole thing I shared with you at the very beginning? Times needed, just pray, let God's voice permeate. Okay, because you can tell I kind of need to come down a little bit, so we're going to go through that. All right? I want you to say it with me again. Are you ready? Time's needed.
Just pray.
Let God's voice permeate.
Let God's voice permeate.
Now let's all say it together. Ready? Time's needed. Just pray. Let God's voice permeate. Now I want you to close your eyes. No exceptions. Close your eyes. I'm not going to do anything weird. I'm not going to spray you or anything. All right, we're going to do it again. Are you ready? Time's needed.
Just pray.
Let God's voice permeate. Say it one more time and let's say it together. Keep your eyes closed. Ready? Time's needed. Just pray. Let God's voice permeate. Look right here. I have taught you a way to remember Philippians 4:8 to filter every thought that comes into your mind, because time's needed. Just pray. Let God's voice permeate. You remember that, and you anchor in your mind what each of those things reference, and you will be able to use Philippians 4:8 in your arsenal, your sledgehammer of breaking down those walls and those concrete barriers that have been erected in your mind, so that you are able to take every thought captive, make it obedient to Jesus Christ, so that you can be successful not only in life, but it translates into every area, your business, your marriage, your parenting, when you yield yourself to God's way of thinking. So let me just wrap it up with this. Remember how I said you believe in God, you're going to believe more in you? Well, you know, when you believe in the Lord, when you allow what Christ accomplished on his cross, his death, his burial, his resurrection, as the only effective means of repairing the breach that's occurred between you and God, and you allow him to reconnect you, the two of you, that's when you can tap into the transforming power that God has made available to you. And when you tap into the transforming power that God has made available to you, then you can know that in time, which we all need, when I am praying, when I am allowing God's voice to permeate, I can see God transform my thinking, my life, my business, my marriage, my parenting, whatever that looks like for you. Not because you are all that, but because God is all that. Thank you guys so much.